Thank you. I wanted to take a quick, oh, and also it's actually Las Vegas, not Los Angeles, but want to take a quick survey. How many of you have actually shopped from Zappos before? Oh, wow, very cool. So normally when I do this survey, the ratio is actually about 2-to-1 women to men, and a lot of guys I ask if they've shopped from us before, and they say, no, they haven't personally shopped from us, but their wives or significant others have, and a lot of times it's actually on their behalf. And I was giving a tour to an executive from one of the major record labels a few years ago of our headquarters in Henderson, which is a suburb of Las Vegas, and would definitely recommend any of you next time you're in Vegas to come take a tour of Zappos. We actually offer tours to the public Monday through Thursdays. We'll pick you up from the airport in a Zappos shuttle, give you the tour, and then drop you off at your hotel afterwards. And so as I was giving this tour, I asked this executive if he had shopped from Zappos before, and he said, no, he hadn't personally shopped from us, but he suspected his wife had, because these white boxes would show up on his doorstep, and then they'd disappear, and he'd have no idea what was going on. He didn't know if she was buying stuff or exchanging or returning shoes, and every time he asked her, she would just flat out refuse to answer him and change the topic. So during this tour in Henderson right now, we're spread amongst three different buildings, and in the building I'm in, it's the merchandising department, and then we go upstairs to our customer loyalty team, which is what our name is for our call center, and there's these there's this whiteboard there that you'll see when you come take a tour that says a number of phone calls we took yesterday, percent we answered in 20 seconds or less, sales through the call center, and so on. And as I'm explaining through all these different stats, I turn around, and he's disappeared. And I'm like, oh, that's kind of weird. So I actually go try to figure out where he is. I finally find him. Turns out he had gone halfway down one of our aisles, sat down next to one of our customer service reps, and forced her to pull up his wife's account. And he discovered that she had spent over $62,000 in her lifetime so far. So hopefully we weren't instrumental to any divorce proceedings or anything like that. So this is what our current headquarters looks like in Henderson. We actually announced about 2 years ago that we'll be taking over the former Las Vegas City Hall. The city was just literally still operating out of that old City Hall last year. And they recently moved into a newly built City Hall. And for us, our whole philosophy at Zappos is it's all about company culture. And really, our brand over the years, we've been around for about 14 years now. We're now doing well over $2 billion a year in gross merchandise sales. And our whole belief is if we get the culture right, then that's going to drive the customer service, which is what we want our brand to be about. And most of the other stuff, like building a long-term enduring brand or business, will just be a natural side effect of really getting the culture right. And so being spread amongst three different buildings has actually had a significant impact on our company culture, because the people at the top of the hill in the building at the top of the hill hardly ever see the folks at the bottom of the hill. So we've actually been looking for at least the past 6 or 7 years to find a place where we could house everyone under one roof and have enough land to expand upon. And it was actually surprisingly hard to find anywhere in the entire Las Vegas Valley area. And then we found out about the City Hall opportunity, and we're actually about 2 months away. We'll be moving in September into City Hall, which is located in downtown Vegas. And so we're super excited about it, and we asked our employees, we finally get to have our permanent headquarters, our permanent campus. What do you want in your dream campus? And we got all sorts of different responses back. And I actually toured a bunch of really cool corporate campuses, like Nike, for example. One of their buildings has this running track around it. And then there was another building that had an on-site pub. And we thought to ourselves, we need one of those. And so, and actually it turns out there's actually jail cells in City Hall. And so we're thinking about turning that into a speakeasy bar. If we do that, I think the name of it should just be Bars. And so so I toured Nike, toured Google, and Apple as well. Amazing campuses. And we started getting requests from employees, and they wanted an on-site gym and an on-site pub and so on. But the number one request we got from employees was actually doggy daycare. More than human daycare. So as we start getting all these requests from employees, we realized a couple things. One was that we couldn't possibly physically, it was just physically impossible to fit all of these things into our campus. But the other thing we realized as we started thinking about it more was all those other campuses, Apple, Google, Nike, were great for employees, but they were actually really kind of insular and didn't really integrate or contribute to the community around them. And so as we started thinking about it more, we thought to ourselves, well, what if actually we turned the entire thing inside out? What if we took an approach that was more like NYU, where the campus kind of blends in with the city and you don't really know where one begins and the other ends? And rather than just focus on ourselves, what if we focused on the ecosystem and the surrounding community? And in the long run, that's going to ultimately help us attract and retain more employees. So that's actually what led to the formation of a downtown project, which I'll talk about in a little bit. But coincidentally, about 3 years ago, a bunch of Zappos employees, myself included, discovered this area of downtown Vegas that most tourists don't know about called Fremont East. In fact, most, I'd say, locals in the entire Vegas Valley area don't even know about Fremont East. And in any of these places, you'd actually have no idea that you were in Vegas. Most people, when they think Vegas, they think of all the big casinos on the Strip, which, as it turns out, is actually technically not even in the city limits of Vegas. Or if they know anything about downtown, it's the overhead light show, the old casinos, and so on. But if you go to this Fremont East area, there's no gaming, and it's actually one of in any of the bars or cafes, and so on. And it's actually one of the most community-focused places. I would actually say the most community-focused place I've ever lived. And I grew up in San Francisco, but I've never actually lived in a place where the bar owners hang out in each other's bars all the time just to support each other and the community. And so it was just this magical coincidence that where this Fremont East area just happens to be two or three blocks away from City Hall. So that's really what led to the formation of Downtown Project, which is a separately funded company. As mentioned earlier, Zappos was acquired by Amazon a few years ago. But actually, it's very different from most of Amazon's other acquisitions, because in most of their other acquisitions, the plan is to integrate the company being acquired into the parent company. Whereas for us, we told them we'd only consider such a scenario if Zappos could remain independent and we could have continue to grow our own culture, which is very different from Amazon's, our brand, and our way of doing business. And happy to report, almost 4 years later, they've actually remained totally true to their word. From our point of view, they serve as kind of like our equivalent of our board of directors. So that's on the Zappos side. Separately from Zappos, formed a company called Downtown Project, which is just privately funded by myself and a few other friends. And so we don't have any outside investors, which allows us to really do what we want and take a long-term approach. And it has a $350 million budget, and then you can see roughly how it's allocated. And I'll go into each of these in a little bit more detail. So there's a few different goals for Downtown Project. One is to help create a place where you have everything you need to live, work, play within walking distance. Another is to help make downtown Vegas the most community-focused large city in the world, and probably the place you would least expect it. And third is to make it the co-learning and co-working capital of the world. And for those of you who may not be familiar with the concept of co-working, it's something that I think started out in San Francisco 8 or 9 years ago, where in one big physical space, they house lots of different tech startup companies. And what they learned through that was people started overhearing each other's conversations and having these serendipitous encounters and collaborating just because they were in close physical proximity. And that really drove a lot of innovation. And so since then, it's worked out so well that there are literally thousands and thousands of co-working spaces all around the world now, and not just in tech, but also in fashion and photography and culinary. And you can imagine, really, you can build a co-working space around anything you can build a community around. And so our whole approach for Downtown Project, which is pretty different from most real estate redevelopment projects that kind of have these shorter medium-term cash flow needs or ROI goals, rather than focus on the short-term ROI, we are focused on maximizing the long-term ROC, return on community. And then the other thing we're really thinking about a lot is this concept that I stole from Jim Collins' latest book, Great by Choice, ROL, Return on Luck, which seems like a very odd thing to actually try to improve. But we actually do a lot of thinking about how do we actually accelerate serendipity within the community and within the downtown area. And I'll go into some of the metrics that we actually look at and think about how do we actually increase luck. So the big bet is really by focusing on these three C's, collisions, community, and co-learning, that that's not only going to lead to a happier and luckier community, but actually innovation and productivity increases. So quick breakdown of how this is broken up. $50 million is being set aside to invest into, let's call it 1 to 200 small businesses to help build a sense of neighborhood and community. And we're actually very anti-top-down master planning, and our approach, and similar to how the Zappos culture evolved, is we want it to be organic and bottoms-up driven and driven by the community. So separate from Zappos, we actually offer a downtown project tour every day as well. And it actually goes through my apartment, which is a little weird in the morning when I'm in my pajamas still. But this is actually my apartment wall. There's a bunch of post-it notes on the wall. And basically when tours come through, we just ask people, what do you want in your dream neighborhood? And if it's not already on the wall, we encourage people to write it down and put another post-it on the wall. But the other cool thing that happens is every once in a while, we get someone whose lifelong dream is to, say, retire 10 years from now and start a cupcake bakery. And we say to them, well, rather than wait 10 years, why don't we invest in you now? And you know, that'll help build community, and you can actually start living your dream, that what you actually, you know, what your true passion is. So we have a few different criteria. We want the small businesses to be owner-operated. They need to be super passionate about it. It needs to help build community, and this is actually analogous to how we hire at Zappos. So when we, because culture is so important to us, everyone that we hire at Zappos actually goes through two sets of interviews. The hiring manager and his or her team will interview for the standard stuff like fit within the team, relevant experience, technical ability, and so on. But then our HR department does a separate set of interviews purely for culture fit. And they have to pass both in order to be hired. So we've actually passed on a lot of really smart, talented people that we know can make an immediate impact on our top or bottom line. But if they're not good for our culture, we won't hire them for that reason alone. And similarly, when we make investments, whether it's on the tech side or small business side for a downtown project, in addition to it being a good investment, it also needs to help build community. So even if there's like a great money-making opportunity, if it's not going to help build community, then we'll actually pass on that investment. We need confidence in their ability to execute. It needs to be sustainable in the long term. Unique, first, or best is really important to us. We get a lot of people that approach us and say, oh, I've seen this great bar concept or chain or restaurant chain that in seven other cities, and you guys should open one up in downtown Vegas as well. And we actually say no to those because we don't want to be the eighth. We want to have our own unique vibe and identity. And story-worthy is important to us as well. So this is Natalie, and she worked at the one of the strip or one of the casinos as a chef for 10 years, actually. And I randomly, serendipitously, ran into her at the local coffee shop. And it turns out that she had just quit her job. She was sick of working in the casino environment and was actually packing up her bags, ready to leave Las Vegas and go to Santa Fe. And as we were talking, and then she also, while walking the dog, ran into some other folks from her team. And so through a series of conversations, learned that her lifelong dream was to retire, or to get out of the casino business, but her lifelong dream was to one day open up her own breakfast and lunch restaurant. And so we started talking, and actually thought she was great for the community. And so this was actually one of the first small businesses that we funded. And you can see her location under construction. I'm actually not a PowerPoint person, but I'm very proud of that transition. So we're going to look at that one more time. Thank you. And so you can see it under construction. This was about 8 months ago. And then she's been open 8 months now. And it's actually doing almost triple her original projections. And so it's just really fulfilling to see that she's living her dream, and it's doing well financially. And on top of that, it's become this new community hub where it's a normal thing to walk into there, and during the course of breakfast, you'll just run into 5 to 10 people that you recognize. And it's always, you can't predict who it's gonna be, but it's really that feeling of serendipity happening all the time. This was still a check cashing place last July, and this is what it looked like on the inside. And then this is Sarah, whose lifelong dream was to open up her own boutique clothing store. And so that was another one of the early small businesses that we funded. And she actually describes it as a hangout place that happens to sell clothing. And people in the community actually will co-work out of there on laptops or just stop in several times a day just to check in and see who else happens to be hanging out there. We're opening up in later this fall a shipping container park. And it was pretty cool. Actually, yesterday, right before flying here, actually saw that shipping container being lowered onto the property. And the guy there is actually a guy named Ern, whose dream was he actually used to work in customer service at Zappos and left before any of this downtown project stuff because he was passionate about barbecuing. And basically inside the shipping container park, that's actually he's gonna be opening up a barbecue eating place. And so he was super happy to see that shipping container come. At night, there's also gonna be nighttime programming for the container park. There's an immersion dome, and then that's actually a 40-foot praying mantis from Burning Man that shoots out 12-foot flames. And then it's kind of hard to see, but towards the top, outdoor live music stage. And there'll be different food and beverage options and retail all around. But the focus is actually gonna be in the center here where we're basically looking to build a kid's paradise. So there'll be these giant blue Lego types of blocks. We're actually building a 25-foot tall Swiss Family Robinson treehouse type of thing. And the idea is make it such a fun place for kids that they're begging their parents to go there every weekend. But at the same time, the adults can hang out with their other adult friends, watch live music, enjoy their wine and cheese and so on, knowing that their kids are safe. And then we also want to incorporate different educational activities in all the retail. So for example, if there's a flower shop, then the kids can go there and do a tent and maybe have a passport where they get to go to the different retailers there. And if there's a flower shop, they can go arrange flowers or learn something about flowers and so on. We're doing bike sharing and actually car sharing as well. We announced I think it was about 2 months ago, that we actually placed the largest US order of Tesla cars. We ordered 100 Teslas, and the idea is basically we want people to get rid of their cars and really use the bike sharing, car sharing, and so on. So that's kind of the small business side. On the tech side, we're allocating $50 million to invest in tech startup companies. And this has actually been surprisingly the fastest growing part of everything that we've been doing, because a few years ago, the tech community was basically non-existent in Vegas. And it turns out, actually, there were a lot of tech companies in Vegas, but everyone thought they were the only tech company in Vegas. And then we helped fund the build-out of a tech library. And now if you go here Thursday nights, there's sometimes a couple hundred folks just showing up just to mingle with other tech companies. And within the past year, we've relocated, and this is just through our Vegas Tech Fund, I think almost 30 tech companies from other states or even other countries to downtown Vegas. And we asked them, like, what is your reason for relocating? And they say it's for two reasons. One is because of the sense of community, and that kind of becomes this self-feeding thing because we filter for that, and we only make investments in entrepreneurs that care not only about their company but actually helping out the ecosystem and the community. But the other reason is really this whole idea of thinking of the city as a startup. And how many opportunities in a lifetime do you have to help shape the future of a major city? We're partnering with Venture for America, which is like Teach for America, but for college graduates that want to become entrepreneurs. Partnering with Teach for America for doing not only what they're already doing, but also they're relocating their Vegas headquarters to downtown. We're opening up an early childhood center that's initially going to be 6 weeks through kindergarten, but then every year we'll add a grade or two, so it'll eventually include K through 12, and it's about teaching kids creativity and entrepreneurship using the latest research from neuroscience. And then we partnered with Burning Man to actually, we had an urban burn downtown, and part of that was we took over a monthly arts and music festival called First Friday, which regularly draws 20 to 25,000 people each month and is this great community event. We're bringing large-scale art to downtown Vegas, so this is 45 feet tall. It's been at Coachella and Burning Man. And the idea is just through a combination of fire stuff like the Praying Mantis or large-scale art, just get people to walk another half a block and then just get them to walk another half a block after that. And there's actually a live picture of the Praying Mantis. And then actually at the end of this presentation, I'll play a quick video. In October, last weekend of October, we're actually launching the Life is Beautiful Festival, which is actually a music festival, a culinary festival, a learning festival, and an arts festival. It's actually four different festivals, but all combined together. And we're fencing off 15 city blocks, which has actually never been done before in any city. So think of that as almost like South by meets Coachella, and I'll play the lineup video at the end. And then we're investing $200 million into real estate. This is actually a really great book, would highly recommend. It's just interesting, even if you're not involved in anything related to urban planning. Triumph of the City by Ed Glaser. He's a Harvard economics professor, and in the book he studied cities from all different time periods, Rome, New York, Detroit, and looked at why some thrived and some didn't. And some of his conclusions actually are pretty counterintuitive, but we're actually, a lot of the way we're approaching things at Downtown Project is actually inspired by this book. And one of the really interesting findings is every time the size of a city doubles, productivity or innovation per resident increases by 15%. But when companies get bigger, productivity per employee generally goes down. So from the Zappos perspective, part of the reason why we think it's really important to invest in the ecosystem and not just ourselves is to try to avoid this fate and to try to create this interesting hybrid between corporation, community, and city that's really never been attempted at scale before. And the ingredients for that to happen are, number one, a residential density of 100 residents per acre, combined with street level activity for those residents to collide, so all those post-it notes that you saw. And the third is the cheapest, but also the hardest, but I think also gives you the most leverage, this culture of openness, collaboration, and sharing. Because if people are twice as likely to talk to each other, then maybe you only need half the residential density. And so it turns out that a lot of the stuff that we've been thinking about and doing at Zappos for the past 14 years in the office environment to try to improve our company culture actually applies at the city level as well. And so, for example, we think a lot about density in the office. Average density, office density in the US is about 200 or 300 square feet per employee. In our Henderson offices right now, we're at about 120 square feet per employee. And once we move into the former City Hall, we're actually going to be under sub 100 square feet per employee. And the reason why we think density is really important in the office environment is because research has shown that when you sit twice as far away from someone in an office environment, you don't see them half as often. You see them half as often squared, so a quarter as often. And it's similar to how the inverse square gravity law works. And so same thing, similarly, thinking about that in the city environment. And at Zappos, we actually prioritize collisions over convenience. So for example, in the building I'm in, there's actually doors on all four sides of the building. The parking lot's in the back of the building. And the previous tenant just allowed employees to go in and out whichever door was most convenient to them. We actually have all our employees go through in and out only the front door because even though they have to walk all the way around the building, that allows more opportunities for collisions in the lobby of the building. And for City Hall, you can't see it, but off on the left is our parking garage. And when the city was city employees were occupying this building, they would park in the parking garage, walk across the sky bridge, and then wind up inside City Hall. Well, we're actually shutting down that sky bridge, forcing employees out onto the street so they have more collision opportunities with other people in the city, and then they'll walk through a central plaza, which will kind of serve like an outdoor lobby and collision point for our new campus. And so the big bet is, and this is just a partial list, we'll have all these different creative entrepreneurial groups colliding in a relatively small space that are, you know, have a predisposition for sharing and collaboration. And just if you get them all together, then statistically, the magic will just kind of happen on its own. And one of the things we realize is that culture is to a company as community is to city. It's the exact same concept, just at a different scale. This is actually the building that I live in. It's a high-rise called the Ogden. And there's, I think, about 275 units in there. And it was built in 2007, right before the real estate crash, for, I think, $135 million, originally as condos, less than 10% sold. And then Starwood came and bought it for, I think, $35 million and turned it into apartments. Well, collectively, in our group, between Zappos employees, downtown project employees, and employees of companies we invest in, we're leasing about half the units in this building. And in this building, we actually have about 80 bedrooms, furnished apartments, that we've basically set up as free hotel rooms. So next time any of you are in Vegas, I actually invite you to come and stay with us. And it's actually been our best tool, because basically anytime we run into someone interesting and friendly, we just say, hey, next time you're in Vegas, come stay with us. And what happens is they're essentially tricked into going to the local coffee shop and the local bar and so on. And then the community just kind of sells itself. And then one of the totally unintended consequences of all of this is, and it makes sense in retrospect, but was not planned at all from the beginning, was that these people also end up meeting each other. And so, TED, this conference, Summit Series Southwest, there's all these great annual conferences that happen, and there's two reasons for going. Half the reason, half the value is for the content, and the other half is just, you just run into interesting people a lot of times serendipitously. And these are great annual events, but what Downtown Vegas is becoming is almost like we're throwing a mini conference every single week now. And so when people come and visit, we'll just kind of see who happens to be in town this week, and then we'll ask a few of them, hey, as long as you're in town, do you want to give a short, 20-minute talk to the community? And I'd say 95% of people say yes, and so then that becomes content for the community, and all of that is free for anyone in the community. And so, on the most prominent corner of all of Las Vegas, Fremont Street and Las Vegas Boulevard, we bought a building there, and rather than turn it into a bar or a restaurant or an easy money maker like McDonald's, we're actually turning that into a speaker's theater called Inspire Theater. So it's under construction right now. Construction should be done around in a couple months, and so you can, and around it, there'll be, in addition to the speakers, there'll be different collaboration and co-working spaces all around. It's two stories, plus there's a rooftop bar as well. And so so pretty excited about that. And so it used to be we would invite people to come and say, oh, you should come during the first week of every month, during First Friday week, because then they can check out the Arts and Music Festival. And then we found out that that there ended up being like a 3, sometimes 4-month waiting list for people to come that week. So we actually started theming each of the different weeks. So the first week is still First Friday week. Second week of every month is a tech focus week, where tech entrepreneurs and investors all come. And the third week of every month is a fashion focus week. We get a lot of designers that come, and they'll tell their story of how they got started and where they're going. And then fourth week we call Catalyst Week, which is, you can think of as almost like a younger version of TED, and includes social entrepreneurs and so on. And this is actually Stitch Factory. It's the fashion incubator that we funded, and different emerging designers go there and set up shop. And Cirque du Soleil has also made costumes out of there, and so it's been pretty cool for helping build up the fashion community in downtown. And so when we first started this project, we thought, okay, we have to invest a lot into residential in order to get to that 100 residents per acre, because there actually is not a ton of residential there aside from the building that I happen to live in. And then started thinking about, okay, why do we want residents? What is actually the value of a resident that's out and about in the community? And started doing the math on, say, someone like me, where I'm out and about in a collisional way, collisional meaning like in a semi-public place, like a restaurant or bar or cafe, or walking down the street, 3 or 4 hours a day, times 7 days a week. I travel a lot, so let's call it 40 weeks a year. If you do the math, it works out to roughly 1,000 collisional hours a year for me. And then this is Jake. He actually lives in New York. And he actually, when we met him, he actually had the most successful fashion-related Kickstarter campaign at the time. Raised about $300,000 on Kickstarter. He's actually since then blew that away and raised over $1 million on Kickstarter. And we're like, wow, like fashion, you could totally help out our other fashion entrepreneurs that are just getting started. Why don't you move to downtown Vegas from New York? And he said no, he couldn't because his factory's out east, his significant other is out east. But what he said he could do rather than move is actually, because he knew about we were trying to do this fashion focus week on the third week of every month, he could come out for that week. And he's been doing that every month. He's been giving lectures and having office hours and mentoring other fashion and tech startups. And so started doing the math on someone like Jake. What is the value of a purposeful visitor that is here to contribute to the community? And when he's here, when he's in downtown Vegas, he's there 12 hours a day, times 7 days a week, 12 times a year. It actually works out to about 1,000 collisional hours a year as well. So we still want people to move to downtown Vegas, but now we have this really interesting layer thing that we can layer on top of that to really accelerate everything we do, and it's a whole new concept of help of what it means to become part of the community of a city. And so we've been calling that subscribing to downtown Vegas, and it's been really interesting because people like Jake come monthly, there's some people that come quarterly, and so on. So basically, going back to this original formula, instead of 100 residents per acre, instead, we modified our thinking to 100,000 collisional community hours per acre per year, which works out to 2.3 collisional hours per square foot per year. I like to tell that stat to our real estate partners because it freaks them out, but it just gives you a whole new perspective in terms of lens through which to think about what are the types of small businesses to open and how do you actually increase more collisional hours in the community based on the amount of real estate that you have. And so based on those three C's, collisions, community, and co-learning, and the reason why actually we chose these three C's is because we wanted something that could be replicated to other communities and cities. And I think a lot of revitalization projects are based on, oh, if we build this really expensive performing arts center, or if we get this sports team, or build a stadium, or have a Harvard or Stanford, and that's not possible in every community. And so our big bet is by having these three C's, collisions, community, and co-learning, what people will say about downtown Vegas, whether they're a visitor just visiting one time, or a subscriber or a resident, is that downtown Vegas will make you smarter, which is probably the last thing most people would associate with anything associated with Vegas. So there's this kind of common theme of inspiration that we try to have run through Zappos. Delivering Happiness is a book I wrote that we ended up spinning off to another company to help other companies develop their own strong cultures, and there's also an apparel line associated with that in Downtown Project. And we just passed the threshold in human history where for the first time, and I think this is just in the past 2 or 3 years, for the first time, 50% of all humans now live in cities. And within our lifetime, it's going to become 75%. So we view what we're doing in downtown Vegas as much bigger than just about Vegas. And in some ways, it's kind of analogous to the story of the 4 Minute Mile, where, for those of you who may not know, for the longest time, people thought it was impossible to run a mile in 4 minutes. Or even if you did, as soon as you crossed the finish line, you'd probably collapse and die. And then in 1954, this guy named Roger Bannister broke the 4 Minute Mile. And the funny thing is, within a year, other people broke the 4 Minute Mile. And it wasn't that nutrition was better on Earth that year, it's just that people believed it was possible. So if we can make downtown Vegas a place of inspiration and creativity and entrepreneurial energy and discovery and so on, and probably the place people would least expect it, then there's really no excuse for any other community or city. And so we want downtown Vegas to be the 4 Minute Mile for the world. If you want a copy of this presentation, feel free to email me, tony@zappos.com, or stay in one of our furnished apartments, and check out downtownproject.com. One of my favorite quotes is actually, I think it was from an executive from one of the major ad agencies, said, "A great brand is a story that never stops unfolding." I think the same is true for a company, a city, and a community. And that's why I am super, super excited to be a resident of downtown Vegas, because I can't wait to see what unfolds next. And thank you very much. So I think we're gonna before we get into Q&A, gonna play the lineup video that just came out, I think 2 weeks ago, for the Life is Beautiful Festival. It was actually shot by another one of the small businesses we invested in, a local film and production company. So you can play the video, please. I think we're going to do Q&A now. Cool.
Have a seat. Hi, I'm David Brooks. I've been to many Aspen Institute events over the last 10 years. And I know you didn't come here to hear me speak. You came here to hear yourself speak. Let's go straight to Q&A. We've got about 15 minutes left. I assume we have microphones somewhere. There's a microphone. And there's a microphone. And I see a question right here.
Hi, I'm Buzz Zano here in Aspen. Can you do this in the Bronx? Because I am from the Bronx.
Okay. Hopefully, I mean, that's part of what why we offer the tours, and we actually have this whole program, you know, depending on the week, where people come in Wednesday and then fly out Saturday and Sunday, and then part of it is the speakers and showing them the community, but then a lot of it is actually just self-directed, and what we found is people from other communities will get inspired and take bits and pieces of what we're doing, and then hopefully take it back home and apply to their communities. So it's hard. I'm not from the Bronx, so I can't comment on that. But I think, you know, human connection with actual people like that, that's part of all of our DNA and biology. And so as fast as technology has changed, I think you know, a lot of what's been interesting seeing the reaction of visitors that come is they don't even realize until after they've been in town for a few days, and that's actually enough time for them to become part of the community, of they don't even realize that that's what they've been inadvertently missing if they're living in a suburbia house, for example, where they don't know their neighbors and don't really and spend their time commuting instead of interacting with each other.
Okay. If we get a microphone right in the front here, and then yeah, we'll get two in the front here, right here.
Thank you for a great presentation. Three quick questions. Where'd you get Zappos? What are you going to do with the 100 Teslas? And I hear on the radio 120 degrees in Vegas today. How does one live there?
Sorry, what was the first question?
The first one. How'd you get the name Zappos?
Oh, okay. So the Spanish word for shoes is zapatos. And the founder, I originally got involved with Zappos as an advisor and an investor. And the founder said, oh, what if we called it Zappos, and I said, that sounds like Zappos, so my contribution was I added an extra P, and actually the original name for the company was ShoeSite.com, but then we realized that was kind of like calling a store, and so then we came up with Zappos. Number two, 100 Teslas, the idea is really to have combined bike sharing and car sharing into a single app, and so the app knows where you are, and then you can say where you want to go and how quickly you want to get there, and then it can give you different options. You can say, oh, you can walk 8 blocks, or you can walk 1 block and get on a shared bike, or there's a Tesla like 3 blocks away, and so it'll give you different options. And we wanted to make it compelling enough where people would actually want to get rid of their cars. And then, sorry, what was the third question?
Temperature.
Oh, temperature. That's why I'm here. So, so I think there's 2 months of the year, I forget which months, where the average temperature is over 100 degrees. But unlike here, everything's air conditioned. Once the sun sets, I actually love Vegas summers. It's amazing to be outside at midnight, and it's 80 degrees out. And so one of the places that we have right now, we actually bought a casino and took out all the gaming, and by day it's a co-working space, and by night it's this kind of hangout place, and we have an Airstream in back and have live bands out there, and just being outside at night, hearing a live band is pretty incredible weather-wise.
We'll go right here.
Really, that was my question was climate. I'm David Daller from Dallas and Aspen, and embrace new urbanism and really exciting about what you're doing. I was just curious. I wouldn't want to be walking for those 2 months during the day, but you know, I think you've covered that. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Let's go right behind you.
Josh Newman from Los Angeles. So I've spent a lot of time in Vegas over the last couple of years, tech shows and whatnot, and that sure does not look like any Vegas I've been to. And my question, which is going to sound flip, but what about old people? It has a very young feel. I mean, and again, I'm not being flippant. This is such a young concept, seems geared toward the young. What are your thoughts on other than the young and kind of the existing community that you find in Vegas, which is not that young?
So our belief is it's as long as they're friendly, I think actually the key is, not the this wasn't in reference to the old people. This is in general. As long as they're friendly, we want as much diversity as possible. Most innovation comes from something outside your industry being applied to your own, and so that's part of the formula. And so, we're totally open to anything that will help build community and create more collisions amongst all different demographics and backgrounds.
Let me ask one question, and this is going to be the unpleasant question, which is my job. So your project is a quintessential Richard Florida creative class project with arts, boutiques, culture, lectures, and things like that. And he has his followers, but there's an opposing school who, there's sort of a backlash against this. And the first argument of the opposing school is, this is more or less window dressing, that if somebody did a study of the 51 biggest cities, all these reurbanization projects, how many people are involved? And it was something about 250,000 people have moved into these projects over the last 10 years. So 250,000 people. How many have moved into places like Henderson within 10 to 20 miles of downtown zones? It's like 20 million. So the real action is going on out there, not here. And so that's one thing that shouldn't concern you. Doesn't really matter whether it's major or not. The second backlash argument, and I don't really have a stake in this, just to make the backlash point, is that projects like this tend to be demographically quite pure. They tend to have zero, according to the critics, zero spillover to less rich people or non-hipster people. They tend to be extremely family unfriendly. They're fine if you're single, but if you want a family structure, if you want schools, they're really not for you, and so they're not sustainable. They tend to be incredibly wildly unequal. The critics say they tend to be incredibly white. And they tend to succeed in a couple places where there are large universities, the Seattles, the Austins. They tend to fail, the critics say, in the Akrons, in the Hartfords, in the places without gigantic university structures. So what do you say?
First, we're actually, there's a lot of Richard Florida stuff that we agree with, but we're actually being guided much more by Ed Glaser's approach. And I think that's probably true for a lot of other revitalization projects. And going back to the diversity thing, and I actually kind of hate using that word because it's such an overused word, but I think we need people from all different socioeconomic backgrounds. And most urban development projects are, I'm guessing, driven by real estate developers that are ultimately, you know, bottom line focused. So it makes sense for them to cater to the folks that are higher up in the socioeconomic ladder. So the only way I can think of to really enforce that diversity is by owning the land, which is why that's a significant part of our strategy. So it's not just going to the highest bidder, but and we can actually curate for diversity.
Okay, fair enough. Let's go right here to the gentleman in the lightish button-down shirt.
Well, first of all, I'd like to commend you on, you know, what is just an incredible project. And we had dinner last night, and we were talking about Detroit, and for sure this is a blueprint, I think, for other areas. But my question is around law enforcement. I wondered if you were working with local authorities as you think about a change in attitude, because what you're trying to do, I guess, is change and shift that behavior and how people interact with each other in an environment where perhaps policing may have been more heavy-handed and perhaps it needed to be. And I wondered if you worked with local authorities to try to shift all of that thinking around these projects.
Yeah, so we actually have, right now I think it's about 20 people on staff, but it's expanding as part of, we've called it the Downtown Rangers, that serve as the interface between law enforcement and community. And it was actually inspired by the Burning Man Rangers. And basically, that team is being overseen by someone who just retired after 20 years in the local police department. It was sergeant there. And so he has all the relationships with law enforcement as well. And they walk in pairs. And so they're not technically security, but they do know, they carry cameras, and they also are meant to be a friendly concierge service, help people with directions, walk people to their cars. If, actually, it turns out that if you want to go running at night, some of them will run with you. But they're meant to be kind of, you know, the kind of straddling that, and it's just, I know they've been around for I think 2 or 3 months now, and it's just kind of a, it's the opposite of how you normally feel when you see security. Like people, like they're just friendly and nice, and it's, I think during the really hot days, they actually carry around these water spritzers to cool you down. So that's kind of a first step, and I think as the community grows and we're basically curating for friendliness, then what we found is people in the community just naturally will watch out for each other more, and so we're less reliant on law enforcement. But at the same time, I think the city wants law enforcement to pay attention, especially to this area, because it's a growing area and important for getting more people to move to Vegas.
Okay, right there.
Cool. So I think all of this is really, really exciting and echo a lot of the comments that a lot of other people made. But something that struck me during your presentation is that it feels like the pieces all kind of align, that there was a synergy of a building opened up and a business that made sense, investors who cared about a bottom line but had values they were interested also. And so I'm trying to imagine how you replicate this type of a model in other places, because you play a really key factor as one individual who's motivating this vision. And so does it take one key business or one key individual to articulate that kind of a vision and motivate in a city that's not Las Vegas and that maybe is a little smaller? What, feedback would you have to folks who are thinking about how to create visions and communities like this in other spaces?
Yeah, what we found, so the headline is $350 million budget, and before that, the headline was Zappos is moving to downtown, and it was an area that people originally thought there's no saving of the place. And what's interesting is we're 2 months away, and I actually think Zappos doesn't even need to move downtown anymore. So it's really going back to that whole concept of just getting people to believe that it's possible. And actually, the really exciting stuff, and the reason why we have people come and visit, is not to come and look at the expensive real estate purchases or the buildings, but it's really the vibe of the community. And people, after kind of the initial orientation, we just say, oh, go choose your own adventure type of thing. And then they'll meet one person, and that person will direct them to two other people and so on. And the consistent feedback is, wow, everyone in this community just has a bias to be helpful. And that's, I think, that what they've told us is that is harder to find from wherever they're visiting from. And stuff like the speaker series stuff, like we're literally holding those for the past year out of construction trailers. Like we had the CEO of Whole Foods come and speak out of a construction trailer, and producer of Batman, and a geneticist who figured out how to combine the DNA of a firefly and a plant to make a glow-in-the-dark plant. So all these random, interesting people, and it doesn't actually cost that much. And what we found is, actually, if you just need to get a group of passionate people together that care about community. I actually just visited Milwaukee, and they have this thing there called Newwaukee, and it's a small group of people, not a ton of money, but I think like Natalie's restaurant, the breakfast and lunch place I talked about. The amazingness of that place is because of Natalie. So I would say don't underestimate what impact a single person can have, and it doesn't have to cost a lot of money.
Okay, we are actually out of time, but Tony has free apartments apparently for everybody, so thank you.